Hi, I'm Meg from PMTV UK, and I recently had the opportunity to chat to the amazing Brian Cahoe from Dunlop about all things pedals. You may have seen our video over on the channel where we chatted about everything to do with acoustic guitar live pedal setups, and he talked us through some of his top recommendations for really bringing your live acoustic sound to life. Making that video and chatting to Brian really got me thinking about what other pedals could potentially work well with an acoustic guitar. So I thought it'd be fun to experiment and give some of them a try. Disclaimer, not all pedals in this video may be known for their use with acoustics, but I thought if we don't try them out, then we'll never know. I was surprised in my video with Brian about how well the MXR bass preamp worked with an acoustic guitar, and it's a pedal I might not have considered before trying it out. It's now regularly on my own board for live shows. So with that said, let's dive into some interesting pedal combinations and see what sounds we can create. So those of you watching might know that I am definitely not the pedal expert at PMT. I play mostly acoustic guitar, so there is a lot of pedals out there that I've never actually heard or tried before. Some of them I don't really know exactly what they do. So I thought I'd bring you in, Sam, a self-confessed pedal geek. And you very kindly set up a pedal board for us to have a look at. So what have you got on there, Sam?
Right, okay, I've kind of put together a bit of a pick and mix for you. I haven't gone for anything super crazy or super wacky. I've basically, and excuse the kind of messy layout, it's been hastily thrown together with cables all over the place. But I've picked kind of something from every category and kept things pretty straightforward. But it should give you an idea of what different types of effects do and how well they work on an acoustic. Yeah. I mean, I'll be honest, I'm quite intrigued by some of these because I'm mainly an electric guitar player. I've never really used a lot of these pedals on an acoustic. I think you have used, I've seen you live a couple of times, and you've used things like EQs and reverbs, haven't you? Which
yeah, I've used a compressor, I think, before, delay, reverb, yeah. Classic acoustic.
Yeah, I mean, we kind of knew coming into this video there are certain types of pedals which are probably going to be more suitable for certain types of acoustic playing. But before we get into the pedals quickly, in terms of the rest of the gear, I've got a Ferndale GA3 Grand Auditorium. What's that you're playing?
So Taylor 314C.
Okay, we're going through a Blackstar Sonic 120 amplifier, and that's mic'd up with a Lewitt Audio LCT-140 air mic, and I've also got the line output going into our audio recorder, so hopefully we can blend the tone a little bit. So it should give you an idea of how these pedals sound going through the amp, how it would do at a gig. So starting at the beginning, I've kind of laid these out in a traditional kind of signal chain. So we start with things like EQs and compressors and then go on to our reverbs and delays at the ends. The first couple of pedals, I kind of call them they're slightly more boring than some of the other things we're going to be looking at. But as we said, they are very practical for acoustic guitarists. The first one is an MXR 6-band EQ, or any other kind of EQ will do the job. Very similar to the EQ that you'll find on an acoustic preamp, but give you a few more little the parameters and bands to tweak. And the good thing about these is what they allow you to do is A, add a little bit of kind of sparkle and depth to what, you know, sometimes piezo pickups on acoustics can sound a little bit bland or a little bit too harsh. So an EQ, a good EQ anyway, will allow you to warm things up and add a bit of sparkle. So to give you an idea, that's our dry sound. I'll flick the EQ on. I can add bass. Range frequencies and then everything in between. So I'm just gonna add a little bit of bass onto that, a little bit of treble. I don't want to go for the classic smiley face, but you can hear how that adds just a little bit of extra kind of sparkle and shimmer to it. And the other really good thing or useful thing with an EQ is for notching out feedback if you are playing at smaller venues at louder volumes, that kind of, or just any venue on a crowded stage or anything.
Very common with acoustic as well, that live feedback.
And that will change obviously from venue to venue, PA to PA. So it will help you find any troublesome frequencies. So for example, if I boost the mids, just to give you the example, You can hear that's kind of on the verge of starting to become a bit of a troublesome frequency. If that was the case at a gig, you can notch that out a little bit and it should. Take away those overtones, which will eventually lead to feedback. So yeah, we already know that an EQ is super practical for an acoustic. The next one though is compressor. And for anyone who hasn't used a compressor before, they basically do what they say on the tin. They compress a signal. So if you've got any kind of like low parts or quiet parts, should I say, or you're playing super loud, it will squash that down. So the quiet parts become louder and the louder parts become quieter. And I really like the sound of a compressor on an acoustic when it's used kind of extremely, mainly on, well, I say on recordings, I think it is. You're a big fan of Crosby, Stills and Nash, aren't you?
Yeah.
And I can't remember the name of the track, but it's the first song on Deja Vu, which is a really heavily compressed acoustic sound. It sounds fantastic.
Rumour has it that was accidentally left on in the studio from the previous really? Recording session.
So they didn't mean to sound like
they
that?
They didn't mean to, but once they plugged in the Martin, they loved it, so they kept it. And it's part of their signature recording sound.
Yeah.
It was an accident.
It brings out the kind of depth and percussiveness of a guitar. So, I mean, to show you an example of the, obviously, that kind of extreme. So if I play. You can hear where it's dragging that volume down when I really hit the guitar, but then it's bringing it back up. I mean, again, this is a super extreme example. I mean, knowing the kind of style of playing that you play, it would work really well for more finger picking, kind of quieter stuff. I'll switch the guitar over. Okay.
So this is without.
That's without the compressor. It's just bringing those slightly quieter notes up when you are finger picking. But then bringing down the quieter parts. So it's just basically a more level, consistent.
Yeah.
And again, that can help in a venue if you have got. If you're a kind of acoustic guitarist that does some real heavy strumming, but also at the same time it can be used to almost make it sound kind of more intimate, I suppose, with the especially for the softer kind of finger picking stuff. But as we said, we already knew that compressors and EQs are great on acoustics. Should we get on to some of the more fun stuff?
Yes, I'm quite excited about the next one.
Yeah. The next pedal in our signal chain is the Electro-Harmonix Pitchfork. And I picked this basically because it's a kind of a do-it-all harmonist pedal. So it's similar to, it's a pitch shifter. It can be an octaver, and it can also work if you get the expression pedal and plug it in the side.
Oh, great.
It can be like a whammy pedal if you're into kind of Tom Morello, Rage Against the Machine style stuff. I can imagine you playing some of that on an acoustic. Yeah. But what a pitch shifter can do is it can be really versatile, it can be really practical on an acoustic, but it can also be quite inspiring and quite fun. And the reason I say I've picked the Pitchfork is because it is very versatile and it's a polyphonic pitch shifter.
Right.
A monophonic pitch shifter, or monophonic octaver, some of the old Boss kind of, I think it's the OC2, things like that, are monophonic, which means that they tend to only work on single notes. This is a polyphonic, so it'll work on multiple chords. And one really cool practical thing you can do with this, if I switch it on quickly, it's just, I'm gonna set it to an octave up and turn the blend probably about kind of 10 o'clock-ish.
Ooh, nice.
It's now given us that kind of shimmer of a 12 string.
Yeah.
So if I turn the blend all the way up, so now you're only hearing the pedal, you're not hearing any of the guitar. That's shifted the entire guitar an octave up. But if we turn that blend back down again, it's effectively... like having a 12 string. So if you were gigging and you kind of... You've got a couple of songs that you wanted to play on a 12 string, but you don't want to take another guitar. That's a really good kind of substitution, quick and easy for getting that 12 string. That's difficult to say, 12 string tone. on the other flip side of that, you can also go an octave down.
Okay.
And this means that you can have bass parts. So. Up so you can't hear the guitar. It gives you an almost acoustic bassy kind of thing.
Yeah.
Which again, it's as a kind of solo singer-songwriter, you might not want to use. But if you are into kind of looping and things like that, it's a great way of putting a bassier part down on a loop, switch it off, and then you've got your standard guitar back. But that's the more practical kind of things to use. And also on the pitchfork, it allows you to have an octave up and an octave down.
Right.
Which is, there's another quite popular electro-harmonics pedal called the POG, which is the same kind of thing, octave up, octave down. You'll hear that in a lot of kind of bands like the White Stripes using, or Royal Blood, people like that. But this also allows you to do things other than octaves. So we can have different intervals. I'm going to switch the guitar over to you. So we can kind of play. So without the pitchfork on. That's the first mode, which is doubling mode. So that's effectively, it's like having a double tracked acoustic in the studio. It's basically the original kind of chorusing. So so with this, you're effectively getting a chorus pedal as well, which we are going to be looking at in a moment. But yeah, that can be used just to fatten up things, give it that little bit of extra kind of movement and modulation. But some of the other intervals on there, we've got minor seconds, if you want to play for a minute.
So I play in open tunings a lot.
You do, don't you? Yeah.
Obviously, some of these are going to be more difficult.
Some of these are definitely not going to work. So that's a major second. So that's a fifth. So that's basically adding. So I mean, not everything obviously is going to sound great. But they can be really good for effectively just adding another. A weirder kind of dimension to little, especially more minimalistic picked riffs and things like that. I mean, with that fifth up there, if I play something like... So... It almost gives it a kind of, like, bell-like quality. And it can be quite inspiring to just come up with ideas and add that extra little bit of something, basically. And what we haven't really mentioned yet is combining pedals together, which we will be doing in a moment. We're kind of just going through these individually to show you what each one does. But when you start mixing this kind of stuff with reverbs and delays, that's when you can get some really fun kind of atmospheric stuff going on, which I'm sure would work really well with, especially if you're there's quite a few kind of like electro folk and lo-fi indie folk, that kind of stuff, which is as experimental as it is standard singer-songwriter stuff. So yeah, pitchforks can be, any pitch shifter should I say, can be really practical, as we mentioned, 12 string bass, or they can just be fun to play with and inspiring basically. We are going to get into the next stage of the kind of signal chain where I'm not entirely sure about these on an acoustic.
Yeah, this is a little bit intimidating to myself, what's coming up next.
We're going to get into the drive pedals. And I've never, ever tried an overdrive or a fuzz or anything like that on an acoustic. So I'm as interested in you at how this is going to sound. I mean, the main kind of difference is, if for anyone who doesn't really know the difference between an overdrive and a distortion pedal and the fuzz pedal, it can be a little bit of a grey area and a little bit confusing, because some manufacturers will make a distortion pedal which sounds like a fuzz, or an overdrive that sounds like a more of a distortion. For example, the Proco Rat is a very famous distortion, but you could call it a fuzz pedal. It's super high gain. As a kind of rule of thumb, it's all to do with the clipping circuits. So an overdrive will have a soft clipping circuit, distortion hard clipping, and then a fuzz, usually a more of a square wave clipping. I'm gonna guess that of the three that I've put on the board here, we've got the Wampler Tumnus Deluxe, which is an overdrive pedal. It's based on the circuit of a classic pedal called the Klon, which is a quite renowned, sought after, expensive overdrive pedal. We've got the MXR Super Badass Distortion, and then the Nano Big Muff, which is based on the iconic classic Electro-Harmonix Big Muff. My guess is, for an acoustic, the overdrive's probably going to be the most practical, but
let's give it a listen.
Do you want to if you want to play something for a minute, just swap. Obviously, there's a huge tonal difference between those. I mean, to be honest, I'm surprised the Big Muff didn't react as badly as the, when you're using a lot of gain, you are going to be more prone to feedback. And obviously,
especially with an acoustic, I imagine.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if you don't play anything, I'll just turn it on. I'm wondering if that's going to straight away. No way of stopping that.
Don't hear that sound much at my gigs.
I don't know, that could be a good opening for you. you are going to have to be a little bit careful with using a lot of gain if you were to use any of these pedals with an acoustic. Again, we've got a very low volume here, so it's not really going to be feeding back. But no, I'm surprised that didn't sound as terrible as I thought it was going to sound. I mean, the overdrive, again, sounded probably the most practical.
Yeah.
In that it gives you that kind of, I'm just going to switch back quickly. So let's just go quickly. It's almost, to me, it gives it a bit more of a lo-fi kind of, boxier sound. It's definitely bringing out the mids, giving it that little bit of crunch. You can imagine artists like C6D, for example, doing his kind of stompy. Let's give it a bit more gain. Have a look. That kind of stuff.
See, that does sound quite cool.
Yeah, it's very bluesy kind of. Very stompy. suppose as well, obviously there's quite a few kind of grungy slacker rock bands from back in the 90s. You think about people like Weezer, for example, who would use acoustics mixed with electrics. Or even going back a bit further, I'm a massive Neil Young fan, I know you are as well. And you think about the likes of Neil Young, he's always gone for that kind of a little bit crunchier, a bit grittier kind of sounds. Bowie, that's another great example, isn't it, with Ziggy Stardust, I suppose. Just gives it that little bit of kind of 70s vibe, I suppose. It could work really well for that. The distortion, I liked the sound of it.
It would, interestingly, not, again, like the fuzz face, not as bad as I thought it would sound. Not sure how I would integrate it into my acoustic pedal board, but it is cool to hear.
Well, I think I'm a kind of big fan of, I grew up on, as I said, the kind of 90s grungy kind of sonic youth and things like that. And actually, I quite like guitars when they don't sound good.
Yeah.
I'm not a tone chaser. So for me, that kind of messed up acoustic sound is pretty cool. Just play a little bit more for us. That feedback we were talking about. Yeah, I mean, it's not something that you're likely to use if you're going to be, I know you do an awful lot of your kind of authentic finger picking folk stuff, but as an experimental thing for especially for the studio, or if you're people into more shoegazy kind of stuff,
it's being a lot of fun.
Yeah, you could definitely have some fun with it. The Big Muff. let's have another listen quick. They're renowned for being quite bassy. And they do work quite well on single note kind of stuff. So if I switch her over, that's interesting as well. So that's your guitar. And that's my guitar. And it's not reacting anywhere near as badly in terms of the feedback. I'm wondering if that's because this guitar uses a PSO under the saddle, and that uses the sensors, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So that tends to be a little bit more lively, so it's great for percussive playing and things, but obviously not for using high gain distortion pedals with. That's kind of the drive pedals then. Yeah, bit of a mixed bag. That's maybe not for every acoustic guitarist. I do think the next kind of couple of pedals we're going to look at, which
this looks a bit more familiar to me.
Yeah, these are modulation pedals, which traditionally on this kind of pedal board in the signal chain, you will put your modulations after a drive pedal or something like that. I've picked a chorus and a phase. The modulation family does include things like flangers, vibratos, tremolos. They all work in a similar way in that they're kind of manipulating the signal, and they're basically moving the way that the waveform is kind of against itself. Yeah, that's a really confusing way of me explaining it. It's probably better if we listen to it.
Yeah, let's give it.
They all produce kind of wobbly effects. Is the best way of the kind of best way of describing it. A chorus, or actually a vibrato, because interesting. This the Blue Hippo by Way Huge that I've picked here is a vibrato and a chorus. A vibrato is pitch modulation. So if we turn it on, I'm gonna turn that depth up so you can really hear it. You can hear it's bringing the pitch up and down, modulating the pitch. What a chorus is that pitch modulation mixed in with the dry signal of the guitar.
Right.
So if I switch over to chorus mode, you can hear the modulation wobbliness, but then you've also got the in-tune guitar underneath it, which is what gives it that kind of sound of two guitars playing against each other that we talked about with the pitchfork up here. Personally, I'd probably recommend using them, this type of modulation effect, a little bit more subtly on an acoustic.
Okay.
Unless you are going for that kind of extreme. I mean, at higher speeds, on a chorus or a vibrato, I'll switch back to the vibrato. You can get that kind of rotary speaker, Leslie cabinet kind of vibe from it. Which again, great for experimenting, but for actually augmenting your guitar tone, if I switch you back over, let's have a listen. Here it's kind of widened the sound a little bit. We are actually recording this in mono, but you can get stereo rigs, especially if you're going to be going straight into a PA system, and a stereo chorus really sounds huge, and can work, I'm assuming it would work really well on your kind of finger picking open tuning stuff. That's set with a pretty low speed but high depth on that. Obviously the other way around is that Leslie kind of thing. Turn the speed down so you can't really hear the movement, the depth up. That's what just gives it that little bit of movement and a little bit of added depth. You probably can hear, though, the noise in the background.
I can, yeah, I did pick up on that.
Yeah, I mean, this is an analog chorus, the Blue Hippo, and analog circuitry does tend to be a little bit noisier than digital circuitry.
Yeah.
There obviously are tons of other choruses out there. Boss make the CE2, which again is an analog chorus, can be quite noisy. But digital modelling units you might find to be a little bit more suitable for an acoustic if you are after that pristine acoustic sound.
Yeah.
I mean, for electric guitarists, I kind of call it character, these added little bits of hiss and noise and things, because you tend to find with valve amps that they're never going to be super clean anyway. But yeah, it's probably going to be more noticeable on an acoustic going directly into a PA system, that added bit of noise. So do bear that in mind if you are looking at modulation pedals, or actually delay pedals as well. The other thing I've picked here is the Phase 95, which is from MXR. It's the phaser. Again, works on the same kind of principle of speed and depth to give you a wobblier sound, but this is changing the phase of the signal as it moves in the cycle, and it's a more kind of psychedelic kind of sound. I know you're into your 60s hippie music, but there you go, if you want to try that. Again, at a slower speed, you don't necessarily notice it's there straight away. It just gives you that little bit of movement. And that kind of sweep, which just opens it up a little bit.
Yeah, definitely.
Again, higher speeds, it is going to sound more extreme. Again, that's a different type of modulation effect that can just add another little bit of character. So that's what modulation pedals do. And as I say, there are other tremolos, flanges, all that kind of thing. But they can definitely sound nice on the acoustic. You've used a delay pedal, we mentioned.
Yeah.
This is a digital delay. So let's just get it back. As you can hear, that's pretty clean repeats on it. As I mentioned earlier, an analog delay is probably going to be a bit noisier. And also they tend to work on what's known as bucket brigade circuitry. So it can definitely add a character to a sound, but the delay repeats themselves don't sound quite as clean. You lose, okay, with every repeat, yeah, you're going to lose a little bit of that signal degradation, basically. So I'd probably say that for an acoustic, if you are trying to preserve that tone, a digital delay. This is the Fender, the new Fender delay, actually, this one, which has got different types of delay on there, but we've got it set to digital mode. And it can work really well for, okay, kind of tempo-based stuff. So if you're... Again, if you try that with a little bit of finger picking or something. It almost gives you, it's kind of like a percussion track in the background. It's you go to an open mic night and things like that, and there's an awful lot of people who are going to be kind of, no offense to anyone who does kind of just strum basic chords and sing along, but if you wanted to do something a little bit different, delays can definitely be a lot of fun too. Kind of add a bit of atmosphere, a bit of rhythm, a bit of texture. And again, you can play around with different speeds, different levels. It can be just there subtly. If we turn down the let's turn down the level a little bit. You can just use them on solos and things. Just to add that little bit of extra kind of a little bit of extra depth to your tone, basically. Pedal is a reverb pedal, and that is the Ocean's 11 by Electro Harmonix. And I picked that basically because it's got tons of different types of reverb on there.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of electric guitarists are going to be familiar with the reverb that's on our amplifier. Something like the Fender at the back there is going to have a spring reverb, which is quite a metallic sounding because it's a spring inside that rattles about. But for acoustics, you probably don't want that type of reverb unless you are after more of a kind of surf guitar sound from your acoustic. What acoustic guitarists are probably going to use reverbs for the most is to, again, add a bit of depth to the sounds, to make it sound like you're playing in various different venues. So just to run through a couple of reverbs there, we're set to, is that hall, is it? My eyes aren't particularly good. So if I turn the time up a little bit, obviously what it might be like to play your guitar. You like a cathedral or something like that. Or if you did want to use it lower levels, we'll make it more of a kind of room style reverb. A lot shorter. Mm. Works really well just to add a bit of a... That's without. Depth. And again, that's something that probably a lot of acoustic guitarists might have on their amplifier already, and you might be using it in that kind of way already, as I say, as part of your rig. There are more fun reverbs though, which can, if you want to get a bit more experimental, this Ocean's 11's got things like a shimmer, which, okay, if I turn it around to shimmer, is that on shim setting? Listen. And this adds an element of a pitch shifter. If you can hear it there, turn the level up so you can really hear it. it's adding like a kind of octave up on the reverb.
Yeah.
Which, so I've never heard on an acoustic, but I'm assuming it's going to sound great. So
it is one of my favourite reverbs, I think, for acoustic guitar stuff.
I think I've seen your pedal. You've got is it a Strymon Big Sky? Oh, Blue Sky.
Blue Sky.
Blue Sky,
yeah.
Which has got a shimmer on it. Yeah. So let's have a little fiddle with it and see what. Something kind of, you know, otherworldly, ethereal, yeah, kind of sound to it. I mean, it is very easy to overuse an effect like that, obviously, but as I say, it can be really great fun to play with. So yeah, I've picked nothing too super out there in terms of, it's effectively one pedal from each category. So there's no kind of weird synths or some of the crazy kind of granular delays or anything like that. But when we start kind of putting them together, we should be able to get some really nice tones and textures out of your acoustic.
I am really intrigued to hear some of these together. See how they sound, especially that pitchfork and the overdrive, surprisingly taken by the overdrive.
Yeah, let's give it a go. Let's have a look. So if we start at the moment, we're completely flat. We will leave the compressor and the EQ out of it for the moment, because these tend to be more kind of tones for, as I say, tweaking the sound,
yeah,
live, depending on the venue. But if we get the guitar back, there you go. Let's start with you. Should we find something pitchy that works with what you're playing? So let's try that. If we try that fifth up first, let's see. That kind of works, isn't it? So without the pitchfork. Keeping the blend down on that, so it's effectively just giving you that harmony at a low, yeah, volume, just to, yeah, sit in the background there. Let's try it with a bit of overdrive just to see if it. It's kind of got a bit of an Eastern vibe to it, isn't it?
Mm.
It's, I forget the name of the instruments, which it's like the percussive kind of bell-like kind of sound, because it's got those overtones of the fifth on top of it. But if we add a reverb to it as well, and I'm going to go a little bit more extreme with the reverb, let's just go with a bigger hall on this one. Quite a kind of a trashy quality to it for, as I say, if you are into those kind of lo-fi indie, yeah, it worked quite well for that. Let's flick the overdrive off quickly. So. Mm-hmm. Let's try. Should we go an octave up on the pitchfork? We'll go for that kind of 12 string E vibe. So that's the pitchfork, an octave up, and the delay, and you're kind of locked into the tempo there. Let's try and make it a bit more psychedelic. Should we try and go a bit more extreme with some of
these?
Let's do it. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. Let's turn off the delay and that. There is also something that you can do with reverbs which can work really well when combined with distortions and things, is to effectively take the dry signal out of a reverb. So if I switch back over to me. So this is a massive hall reverb, but you're not really hearing much of the actual guitar. That's just the reverberated signal now. You can see if we can make some sort of weird kind of... Again, that's if you, from an electric guitarist point of view, if you look at players like, you know, Tom Morello, people like that, they, you know, they've made a career of making their guitars not sound like guitars.
Yeah, that's true.
And there's no, you know, there's no reason why you can't do that as an acoustic player. Because as you say, the good thing about it is you can use them if you are just using kind of ambient intros or interludes between songs. They don't have to be on all the time, obviously. You play something. I'm gonna put this guitar down for a minute, and we'll acoustics. I suppose it's the same as using a, you know, single cord electric guitar with a humbucker, as opposed to a humbucker. Let's try a bit more overdrive and stuff. So yeah, I mean, we've kind of looked at something from every kind of range of pedal as such. We've looked at EQs, modulations, pitch, drive, all that kind of thing. I've come at it from an electric guitarist point of view, and I was a little bit intrigued to hear how some of these would sound in acoustic. But what are your thoughts from a gig in acoustic musicians?
Well, firstly, I think it's been great fun. Some of these pedals I've never even plugged in before. I obviously know what the Big Muff is. I know what the MXR distortions are, but I've never heard them. The pitchfork and the phase chorus, I loved them. I'd probably put them on my board, have a play around. The overdrive surprised me. I actually really liked that too. I don't think I would have a Big Muff on my board. It's probably my one takeaway from this video.
Sure.
Yeah, I think I'm sure. But it's just been so interesting to hear them all through an acoustic, something I've never got to do before. I imagine probably lots of people watching have never heard some of these on an acoustic before, so it's been really good fun.
No, so I think the takeaways, as we kind of half expected coming into this, was there's some pedals which are going to be super practical for an acoustic, as you mentioned, yeah. The EQs and the compressors. But as you said, like the overdrive, for example, it kind of surprised me. We're both big fans of that kind of 70s rock kind of thing, a little bit lo-fi, a little bit. Mm. And it definitely brings a tone which you might want to not use on everything.
Yeah.
But it can definitely give you that little bit of kind of grit and things. I quite like that. And as we said, they are going to kind of fall into more experimental categories. You mentioned the pitchfork. I can definitely... You know, I can hear when you're playing, it could lead on to some great ideas.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, we do, if you wanted to find out more about pedals and things, if you are a complete novice, we have got, we've got a couple of buying guides and beginner's guides. If you did want to find out a bit more in depth of how these do work, this was more of a kind of experiment to see how they work with an acoustic. But yeah, tons and tons of different pedals on our website that you can go and check out. That's pmtonline.co.uk, or go and have a try for yourself down at your local PMT store.
Yeah, absolutely. And the same goes for the other instruments we've used. If you want to find out more about the guitars or the amplifier, then you can see it all over on our website, pmtonline.co.uk. I hope you've enjoyed this video as much as we have shooting it. I hope you found something useful from it, and do let us know in the comments which you thought was the best or worst sounding pedal with this acoustic. And give us a big like and subscribe. We will catch you in the next video soon.
Nice one. Cheers, guys. Are you sure that I can't convince you to get a Big Muff?
Absolutely.